The toughest thing to do right now is just to hang loose, be relaxed. Don't try to grab at anything. Don't strive for 4D protection from what's taking place. There's a tendency right now to try to grab a hold of some sort of protection. 4D protection. Grab a hold of the mind to protect from the mind, as it were. Don't do that. The answer, salvation is very simple. Give perception a different purpose. Give mind a different purpose. Give perception a different purpose. And right now, mind is playing this game with itself. It's always, this existence is a game that mind is playing with itself. It claims there's all these people, separate people. No, that's just a game that mind is playing with itself. We're just like watching this game, watching this movie. We're not really in the movie at all. But we're wondering, saying, this character looks interesting. I'll follow this character and see how it goes with that character. And then we say, well, let me try another character, that character. But it's all a play that mind is presenting to us, to spirit. We're not any of these characters. What happens to all these characters doesn't matter. Makes no difference, doesn't matter. But we can give a different perception. I say, watch a different movie, put a new movie on. Same screen, different movie, as it were. And right now the challenge is to just stay steady. Don't go off on tangents desperately trying to grab something. Very interesting. Because the energy right now is to try and get the mind to help the mind. Protect the mind or something. Now, don't be fooled by all this. Don't be fooled at all. Incredible drama is going on in the world. Don't be fooled by it. Don't think you have to jump in and be a hero. Seems to be so much opportunity to help out. There really isn't. It's a trap. Everybody's saying, help, 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 help. But then when you go to help them, they grab a hold of you and say, you're to blame, you're to blame. So just stay steady. Now, the mind tries to give the mind enlightenment. And it studies of what enlightenment is, and then tries to give this enlightenment to itself. It tries to give enlightenment to the body. It tries to say, here's an example. It says, body, the mind is crazy. It's all wrong. So you should not follow what the mind tells you to do. And so in order to help you not follow what the mind is telling you to do, you need to be exhausted. You need to be sick. You need to be too tired, so you just can't do anything. And then, you see, by not being able to do anything, you will be enlightened. The mind is telling itself this. The mind doesn't know what enlightenment is. The mind cannot tell the mind how to be enlightened. Enlightenment is not something of the mind. It's not something of the person. Keep your personality the same, keep your body the same, keep the mind the same, keep everything the same, and choose a different mode of perception. Give perception a new purpose. And then everything you will choose to see it as defining life for you. It'll be a definition of life for you. So let the dance any way it wants to dance. That's not important. What's important is to choose to see it as a definition of life instead of a definition of death. Right now, everything we're perceiving is a definition of death. And mind tells us, oh, we'll fix it. I'll fix that for you. No, it will not. It gives all these crazy fixes for it. One fix for it. Choose a new purpose for perception and see it as a definition of life. That's the fix for it. There aren't any other fixes for it. the mind will give you a million different fixes and a million different other fixes, which is why you have this incredible mishmash, jambalaya of spiritual paths and techniques and this and this and that, because that's all the mind. The mind is just writing prescriptions like a mad doctor, you know, mad scientist doctor. Here's an RX, here you go. Oh, that didn't work for you? Ah, oh, here's another one. That had side effects? Here, take this and this and this and this and this and this. And so we're all gobbling these prescriptions. Saying, Doc, I don't feel so good. Well, oh, no problem, here's another prescription. So the mind will write infinite number of prescriptions as to try to remedy your complaints, to calm your complaints. But the real remedy is to give perception a new purpose. So instead of watching this movie defining death, which is what this movie is, mine won't tell you that. Or if it does tell you that, it'll write you a crazy prescription for it. This is a movie that is defining death, which is unreal. There's no reality to death. Nothing real could die. Instead of having that movie on the movie, being projected, project the movie of defining life. Whenever you have things form, you have definition. So because we are so used to definition, to scrap it all is a continuity issue with us. So we keep our definitions, things, and yet now we have a different purpose for these things. Instead of using these things to define death for us, we use these things to define life for us. And this is not some sentimental, romantic type of thing. No, it's a perceptual change where what is the things now seem to be in the arms of this beautiful light, bathed in this beautiful light, living light. And then you look at this thing and you say, oh, that's defining life for me. How wonderful. That's defining life for me. This is the way. The other stuff are just prescriptions from the mind. The mind under the presenting the idea of trying to teach spirit how to die is writing prescriptions on how to, you know, get rid of the pain of this presentation. But it's still completely loyal, as it must be, to this idea of teaching spirit how to die, to what it is. So you can bet that no matter what prescription it writes, it has a way to enfold that back into definitions of death. No matter what. So it's like with one hand, it seems to be easing the pain, and then with another hand, it's hitting you, you know, scratching you, which is true. That's exactly what the mind is doing, because we're complaining so much. We're saying, "Mind, we hate this. We want to be free of it." The mind say, okay, here, this is how you get free of it. It's not how you get free of it. That's just a delaying tactic. All the prescriptions that mind writes are just delaying tactics. And meanwhile, it's continuing to cause you immense misery and suffering from all different angles. So the great task is to finally see what the answer is. Choose another idea. Give the mind a different idea. Say, "Mind, I want you to define life for me." That's all right. That's a way of saying it. "Mind, I don't want to be prime creator. I don't want to try to change what I am. I want to accept what I am. Mind, define life for me. Prepare me to step into life. Prepare me to step into timelessness. Prepare me." So you have to give mind new marching orders. Otherwise, it'll just keep marching along, writing prescriptions for you. And you'll keep gobbling those prescriptions and then wondering why you got a headache, saying, you know, as if still feel terrible, mind. Mind says, you're not tired enough. If you're really tired, tired of existence, you're so tired of it, then you'll be free of it. You know, and say, no, I just feel even more tired. So when you choose a new purpose for perception, it's both the perceiver and what is perceived that are now defining life. Because it wouldn't do if you had something that's defining life for you and you're looking at it through, you know, covered glasses or all scratched up glasses. You say, I can't see that very good. So the means of perception also has to be a definition of life, has to be flawless, has to be beautiful, has to be clear, has to not sag or get tired. So the perception doesn't get tired at all. Doesn't get stressed out. The price we pay is the people in the world say, hey, you know, what did you do? What kind of prescription did the mind write for you? You say, no prescription. It didn't write. I wrote a prescription for the mind. See, that's the difference. You just tell them, no, I wrote a prescription for the mind. The mind didn't write a prescription for me. I wrote a prescription for the mind. And they say, oh, that's blasphemous. You can't do that. I said, who says? So the mind says, well, you told the mind to lie to you, so why do you believe it? Tell the mind to not lie to you is the new prescription that we write the mind. So write the mind a new prescription. 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 We're continuing on with what we do. Continuing to push this forward. Now, here's the problem of the times right now. The mind is writing an incredible number of prescriptions. And the prescriptions seem to be really high-techy 4D prescriptions. You're like, whoa, you know, it's like, wow, that's an interesting prescription. And so, people are thinking about taking those prescriptions. Because it's a desperate time right now. We feel the part of the movie's coming up where there's all this death, you know, all this turmoil, and all this loss and redefinition. It's here. I said that this week in June you would feel it very strong. I certainly have, and it's been pushed back just a little bit too into the next week as well, and going up to June 30th, there is just this immense push of redefining society, redefining how we live. An immense change, like a tsunami, is coming. And so the mind is frantically writing prescriptions, and easy to get caught in those. Easy to get caught in those. Remember then that it's not that the mind, we need to do it for the mind to write us a prescription. We need to write the mind a prescription. We're the doctors. The mind is not the doctor. We're the doctors. We say, mind, you are presenting a crazy idea, so we're going to write you a prescription to present a sane idea. How about that? Because we're tired of this idea. We're tired of mind, you pretending to be sick. We don't like this, you pretending to be sick, mind. And then projecting that on us and trying to tell us that we're sick, and we know we're not sick, we know you're not sick. This is all a farce. And so, mind, here's a new prescription. The junkies who go to the mine and say, hey, mine, I need a new drug, one that won't quit, one that won't make me feel tired, make me feel 3 feet thick or something, how that, you know, that song goes, I need a new drug. And we go to the mine and say, mine, I need a new drug, one that won't make me feel terrible. And mine says, sure, no problem, we got plenty. We just need to calibrate you a little bit more. We need to tune you in a little bit more. We need to do a little more of this and a little more of that. And we say, well, mind, how come the last stuff you gave me wasn't so good? And mind goes, well, occasionally people experience some side effects from these things, and your symptoms show us that we need to tweak this a little bit, and we'll tweak this a little bit. And you say, oh, great, great. So the mind is playing doctor. The mind has its white lab coat on, it's playing doctor. And we're playing patient. And it's a silly game for us, for sure. And we should just laugh at the game. It's a very silly game. Spirit going to mind, asking for prescription to feel right. Now that's hilarious, very hilarious. So in looking at all these prescriptions that mind is writing, that's what I do. I look at the internet and YouTube and books and everything, and it's obvious these are just prescriptions that mind is writing. The mind is writing so many prescriptions, and people get the prescriptions and they want to tell everybody, hey, I got this incredible prescription today. Yeah, it's going to save me it's the answer. But the one prescription comes from the Holy Spirit. Doesn't come from mind. The Holy Spirit says, you write mind a new prescription. And that's the one thing we don't do. Because we say, oh, well, I'm not the doctor. I'm the patient. The Holy Spirit says, no, you're playing the role of a patient. You're not the patient. You're saying to my mind, I'm so sick. I'm so sick. I'm getting sicker. What should I do? Mind says, yeah, you're really sick. Wow. I'm gonna help you though. I'm gonna help you. And you say, oh, thank you, Mike. Yeah. But we're not sick. The patient in the movie we're watching is sick. But who's producing the movie? The mind is producing the movie. So you're identifying with the sick patient in the movie. You're saying, wow, very sick patient. What is wrong with them? Well, this poor person is awful, really suffering. Mind, what are you gonna do? And the mind says, in the movie says, mind says, ah, here I come, the hero comes to the rescue. Look what I have for you. Just say this and chant this and do this and this and this and you won't be sick anymore. Look in, and the patient is so grateful. Thank you, mind. You're so wonderful. You're a god, mind. You're a godsend. I worship you. I bow to you, mind. And the mind is like saying, well, and the patient says, mind, what can I do for you? Just anything you ask and I'll do it for you. And mind says, well, there's one thing you can do for me. Just one little thing. One little thing. Just learn how to die, okay? Just learn how to accept your death. That's all I'm asking you. And if you do that, I'll resurrect you from the dead and you will be the prime creator. And the patient says, oh, really, mind? Wow, that's fantastic. I can't thank you enough. So the patient then dies. And mind is like, okay. And mind's waiting for the resurrection. And it doesn't happen. And mind says, huh. I guess the patient didn't accept its own death not sufficiently. So I'll rebirth the patient. I'll have the patient be born again into a slightly different role. Let's try that different role. It's all a movie. Existence is a movie being produced by the mind. Now spirit's just watching all this movie, identifying with the characters. And it's waiting for its own death, saying, hoping if it just identifies with the character that dies completely, then spirit will die. It's hoping that, but alas, it never dies. Spirit never dies. So mind keeps on with these roles, saying, spirit, I got a new role for you to follow. It's incredible. This one is really going to bring about your death. I'm telling you. Spirit says, okay. I want to watch this one. It's like 1001 Arabian Nights. The mind keeps producing these segments of the movie and says, Spirit, you almost died last time. This time you're going to, believe me. Trust me, this one's a whopper. It's incredible. It's really going to work. And Spirit says, oh, okay, I'll watch this one. So Spirit's falling along, and saying, wow, this is really heavy. I can see this might be how to die. This is incredible. And then the Holy Spirit says, are you having fun, Spirit? And Spirit says, well, not really. This is kind of weird. Holy Spirit says, well, how would you like to... My mind's been giving me all this prescriptions and it still feels really weird. Spirit says, yeah, you know, it's always going to feel really weird to you because you can't die. And your attempt to do something that's impossible feels really weird to you. Ah, okay. So what do I do, Holy Spirit? And Holy Spirit says, just write a new prescription for mind. Say, mind, you are now going to present preparation for life. You're now going to define life. All things will now, your movie will define life for me. It'll be a life-defining movie for me. And then my mind will do that. So we write the prescriptions. We write the prescriptions, not the person. The person is just an actor, is just a puppet in a movie. It's just the movie is a projection of mind's imagination. So it's not the person, not the human, the person, the personality, even these sheaths, these bodies we have are just like clothing. They're like definitions. One definition, then you put another definition, like layering your clothing, layering. T-shirt, flannel shirt, sweatshirt, heavy parka, really super heavy, bulky. Parka, windbreaker, rain jacket, you know, layering definitions. And but the fact is, at the core, there's nothing there at all. You know, we're just putting clothes onto nothing, onto a mannequin, as it were. So these various bodies that we have, so-called physical, etheric, emotional, mental, causal, soul body. Those are just definitions. They're not real. They're nothing but the play of mind's imagination. So mind will tell us all these things. You need to integrate this body and that body and this definition. Oh, those are just prescriptions by the mind. Those are all nonsense. Just give you right mind a new prescription. That's all the gurus are saying. The real gurus are saying, you right mind a new prescription. That's the answer. Don't keep listening to these prescriptions that mind will give you all these incredible, incredible prescriptions. Ah, you need to, you know, ascend to the into this body and bring down this light and do da 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 da. You know, it's endless, it's endless, it's endless, it's endless. All these bodies are just definitions, which have nothing to do with what we are. What we are is beyond any definition. We are not sheathed in any definitions. How can endlessness be sheathed? Answer that. How can endlessness be sheathed? What could sheath endlessness? Never endingness. How can you put something around never endingness? You cannot. It's impossible. So the attempt to do so is just making up definitions. So it's not these definitions that are writing up a new prescription for mind. It's spirit. It's spirit that's doing it. And a spirit has to realize that forget about all these prescriptions. All this esoteric stuff are just prescriptions from the mind about how we're supposed to do all this changing of our structure, definition, change the atoms, change this, change that, align this, align that. That's just playing with definitions. That has nothing to do with salvation, with what we are, with life. So when the perceiver and the perceived are now defining life, what happens? Well, you may be glowing, you may be radiant, people may look at you and say, whoa, you know, what's that? What is that? That's the price you pay. That's the price you pay here, is people will think you're some kind of saint or some kind of great being or god or goddess, or, you know, and they say, what prescription did you get from the mind? And you just have to, you know, put up with that. Because they'll all be foolish, you know, people. Most people who come to the enlightened ones are very foolish, because what they're saying is, where do I get that prescription from, you know, from the mind? How'd you get the mind to give you that prescription? And again, that's the wrong question, isn't it? All their questions are based on a false premise, that the prescription came from the mind, that to produce this clear state of perceiving life definitions of life everywhere. And clear perceiver, clear perception, definitions of life, they think it came from a prescription of mind. That's their premise. That's in. It's very difficult to shake that premise. Very difficult. Almost everybody has that basic premise, and they're very adamant about it. And they will cling to that, you know, come hell or high water. And so that's the price you pay in this world. And they will, later on, they'll insist that, no, you got a prescription from the mind, you just didn't want to tell us, or we know what it is now, it's this, or that. I said, oh yeah, for some reason, you just didn't understand it, or somehow your enlightenment didn't quite understand it properly. And so, and historically, you'll go down as somebody who got a particular mental prescription from the mind, even though that's not true. So you will be disbelieved. You won't go down history properly, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's the price you pay. That is a price that you pay. Doesn't really hurt you. Others just to continue to pop these pills, these mental prescription pills, as they've always done. And the answer remains the same always. So it doesn't really hurt them. They're going to be popping some mental prescription pill. You know, it doesn't matter what it is, it still doesn't work. It can be in the name of Jesus, in the name of Krishna, in the name of Buddha, in the name of anyone. A mental prescription pill is still not going to work. So, as Buddha said, don't believe. If someone says that this is what Buddha said, don't believe them. Don't believe it. Because it's a mental prescription pill. It probably is a mental prescription pill. In other words, believe the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit said. Believe what the Holy Spirit said about it. You know, because there are plenty of people who will say, this is what Buddha said. Here's the prescription of what Buddha said, or what Jesus said. And they'll say millions and millions and millions of different prescriptions, and they'll insist, this is it. This is it. It's not. It's not. There's one prescription that works, and that's the prescription that we write, that Spirit writes, the prescription that we give mind. And that prescription presents everything as a definition of life. It is now bathed in this beautiful, subtle light. Different perception. We gave perception a different purpose now. So if they're not talking about that, they're talking about mental prescriptions from the mind. They don't work. They're delaying tactics. The mind can make it seem like it's getting somewhere, but that's all part of mind's ingenuity in lying. It can present a spiritual path, and you think, my God, everything's being redefined, that's redefined, and then you define all the redefinition as progress. But you're just going around in circles. You're just wandering aimlessly, really. Defining your aimless wandering as progress. The mind will make it plausibly seem that way. So forget all about all progress on the path. Forget about all the mental prescriptions and all the progress. No prescriptions, no progress. Just write the mind a new prescription. And then there's no path and no progress necessary. So we're coming to the end of the path and the end of the progress, because we see that all of that was just the mind's prescriptions for us. I say, okay. And the mind is frantically right now writing a prescription for you, as it's doing for me. You need to do this. Oh my gosh, you need to do this real fast, super fast. You gotta just really put on this incredible production. You gotta do this and this and this. I say, no. But it is a time now in the world where many will be lost. To what? Lost to a particularly attractive mental prescription. A particularly attractive prescription by mind. Many will be lost at this time. Many will be lost. that's the times we live in. Hopefully many will be found. Many will snap back, you know, out of those prescriptions. Hope so. But one thing to do, don't go chasing after. You see someone take a prescription and now they're in this condition, don't go chasing after them, because the mind will say, oh, you want to help them? Here's a prescription to help them. No, don't do that. That's what the mind will say. You say, you want to help them? Here's a prescription to help them. And you say, no. The only way they can be helped is to choose a new idea, give purpose a new perception, and write a new prescription for mind. So one has to be very careful in helping others. Now, I don't know if playing some music or something is the right thing or not. I can contemplate on that and see what comes up. But many people now will be pulled into music, which is why I was using music, thinking maybe I can use music, because the temptation right now for many, I tend to relate to artistic types, musical artistic types. So, and speaking to these, the temptation is very severe right now, is to plunge yourself into music, because the mind will write many prescriptions of this song, do this song, and this song, and this song, and this song, and get into it, you know, and you will immerse yourself in this as an attempt to cure this feeling of turmoil, of redefinition, of losing your sense of purpose, of direction. All this, like a sense of loss of identity, is very strong right now. There's a very strong tendency to immerse yourself in that. So I tend to be able to speak to musicians very clearly and directly, knowing what that's all about. And so whether I play some songs or not, I don't know. I could possibly do so. Whether that might cause me a problem versus the right prescription, I'll have to, again, contemplate on that and see. Don't have to do it, but I wonder, it might be helpful. I don't know, it might be helpful. Just to ease that addiction, you know, oh, I need a, it's like electronic cigarette or something. Oh, I need a cigarette, and then there's something, it's, okay, at least I see some smoke. It may be like that. See, oh, okay, at least I hear a little singing, a little music. It's all ragged and shellacky and stuff, but at least it's something. Something. Okay. All right. I don't have to go jump into music. I can get my fix a little bit this way, and then hear the truth along with it, and spend most of the time just hanging out. That's a possibility. You know, I'm toying with that idea, but it's a dangerous one, because the mind will come to me and say, hey, you can really help a lot of people, and then they'll start writing prescriptions to me for what to do, and then I could end up getting really trapped in bad stuff. So it's a tricky situation for sure, but I do recognize the trouble that people are having. There's no question about it. I'm having the same trouble. If you're having trouble, believe me, I'm having trouble too. The tendency lately has been to get immersed in music. That's why I did a playlist of George Jones, I did a playlist of Brenda Lee. I tried to find a music that I felt was just to dive into that would be the very, very best. What's the very best pool of music to dive into? I was in a place today that is one of the most beautiful places in the world, actually. There's a sparkling swimming pool, the mountains, the trees, and sitting up above this, and it's just like incredibly beautiful. And I was just sitting there, so tired, feeling so terrible. I just said, you know, it doesn't do anything for me. I could care less. I could absolutely care less. It's nothing. But the, you know, in looking at the pool, it's easy to think, oh, if I just dove into that pool, everything would be fine. And so the pool's shimmering. It's like a pool of music. If I just dive into that pool of music, I'm going to be fine. But that is a prescription of the mind, okay? It is not giving perception to inner purpose. It is not seeing all things, everything bathed in this living light. It is not that. Music is not that. Absolutely, it's not that. And so that is not, that's a prescription of the mind. Now, the music, if I did it, I would stop the song. I would break it up. I would you know, it wouldn't let you get into it. I'm able to do that, you know. I recognize that it's a little, it's easing through this transition period by doing performance art with music, but breaking it up so you don't feel you can dive into it. They're just puddles there, little puddles, is what it is, puddles. And you splash about the puddles, but you're not diving into the pool. And after a while, you say, I don't really need any music. You know, I'm going to give the mind a new prescription. And then you hear all music bathed in this living sound. Some deep people have said it's some kind of the ohm, or some kind of this universal sort of tone or sound vibration, where all music is bathed in this tone. That's the oral equivalent of seeing things bathed in this living light. Everything, all sound is bathed in this celestial, beautiful, beautiful tone, as it were. So, I don't know, we will see. Perhaps I will make these videos. I don't know if people like them or not, but the purpose of them is to get you through the withdrawal symptoms, the addiction of these prescriptions that mind writes, so you don't fall prey for it anymore right now. Because right now is the time when we are extremely vulnerable to fall prey to more of mind's prescriptions, which will just lead us on another wild goose chase. Terrible wild goose chase. We don't want to do that for sure. We don't want to do that for sure. So avoid that at all costs. And I know, like in the evening, I say, what do I do? And then there's these songs. I say, let me just listen to this one. Then let me listen to this one. And this one. And this one. Before you know it, you're just caught up in this path of listening to these songs. And you forget about anything else. And you think, this is the answer. But it's not. We've been there, done that. It's not the answer. Music isn't the answer. Just like beautiful things are not the answer. Beautiful bodies are not the answer. Drugs are not the answer. All these things are not the answer. We know that. But the mind is still writing us prescriptions saying, hey, you just haven't got the right song yet. When you get the right song, zap, that'll be it. It'll zap all your misery just right there. Just the right song has got to come along. Well, not true. The mind had me writing, composing these songs. I said, this is the right song. If you just write these, this will cure people. No, not true, not true. The mind put on a show of it, a show of being helped, but again, that was just part of its movie. There's no song that is the cure. No song will ever be the cure. Writing mind a new prescription so that everything is now a definition of life, that is the cure. That's the cure. Now you can still listen to this music if you want, but the music will all seem completely celestial. Completely, you will hear this incredible overlay of everything you listen to. Something's trying to get in my ear. What is that? I don't know. You'll hear that. And depending on how you're oriented, some people are oriented towards food and taste, and what they taste, what they feel is this, everything tastes incredibly sweet. Everything, no matter what food they eat, has this wonderful sweetness to it. Tastes like life. And some are like smell, and everything they smell has this incredibly ephemeral, beautiful scent to it that's just impossible to describe. Smells like life, as it, and some touch, that no matter what they touch, it feels celestial or something. There's the feeling is just this, is this boundless, spacious feeling of everything touches this way. So no matter what the senses are, there's a way to for them to be defining life now. As they say, Jesus said, the senses have senses. You know, the eyes have eyes. Behind the senses we have now is the spiritual senses. That's a giving perception a new purpose. All of this sensory stuff. We're having a storm is coming in Sunday, and then Monday and Tuesday it's be raining here. Very rare. It's going to break all sorts of records because this we just don't get these storms in June. So they even said thunderstorms in June. Thunderstorms here in the Bay Area, no way. This is going to be very interesting. I know in the rest of the country they say, oh, that's normal. Here, no way. So that should be very interesting. Something different. However, that is not salvation. That's a mind writing another prescription. Like, hey, check out the thunderstorms in June. That'll be really interesting. I say, okay, but that's not salvation. So I might tack on some musical stuff. We'll see how it goes. I mean, it's something I can do. Will it hurt me? I don't know. Will it be helpful? It's possible. It could be helpful. It's a role I could play, actually, of kind of the very unique role. People haven't really seen it so much. A more performance art sort of thing that kind of helps people get past this very severe situation we're in right now, where there's a tendency to try to take refuge in the prescriptions of the mind, which will be a disaster if you do that. Cannot do that. Don't take refuge in food. That's another thing that I'm feeling very much pressure to take refuge in food and in music and in beautiful things, beautiful bodies, beautiful clothing, all this stuff. There's temptations now are really strong in all and to indulge the senses. Those are all prescriptions of the mind, all of those. So we have to, again, I say, hang loose, be relaxed. Don't jump into those prescriptions. Just stay very, very unattached, very detached. Just keep your disciplines going, which I'm trying to do. I'll try to fast this weekend. You skip breakfast on Saturday and Sunday, and exercise, and just try to stay steady, and power through, keep powering through to the end of June, and try to be of assistance here, setting an example. What else can you do is try to set a good example for others. The problem with the world is there's not enough mentors. There are not enough mentors for setting good examples now in the world. It's just incredible. I wish I could find some. I can't really find any. Or at least it's extremely difficult, and it's just... mentors set good examples. There's so many bad examples in the world right now. So many. People look around, they see all these bad examples, they say, oh, that must be what we're supposed to do. It is not. It is absolutely not. The world is full of people following mental prescriptions. Not just following them, gobbling these prescriptions down and believing in them, saying, yeah, this is it. So many. The world is absolutely chock full of mental addicts who take the prescriptions the mind is writing. And it's not just what intellectual or mental to mental. No, the mind writes prescriptions in every possible way. Millions and billions of prescriptions. They tell you to do this, they tell you to do that, to be like this, to be like that. When you say too much mind, it means we're taking too many of these prescriptions that the mind's writing. And it can be emotional. The mind will say, you gotta be more heart-centered or more emotional. All this stuff are just mental prescriptions. What we need to do is we need to write mind a new prescription. That is the answer. None of the mind's prescriptions are the answer. None of them. They're all equally futile. So don't spend your time judging them on them, because the mind will write you another prescription and say, you know what? All you gotta do is put these prescriptions in order to the best of the worst, like a Scoville unit thing for peppers. You know, this is the hottest pepper and this is the mildest. And if you do that, you'll be saved. That's another lie. That's another prescription. You don't have to catalog them and rate them at all. They're all equally futile. So don't let the mind get you hyperactive right now. The temptation is really there. I can feel it. Because the future is, we're feeling the future now. And we will soon realize that we're in a new definition. The future is going to be redefined for us, and we'll have no say in it. It's going to be completely redefined. And so all our definitions that we're used to, gone with the wind. Gone with the wind. That's why that movie is so powerful, Gone with the Wind, is all those definitions of life in the Old South, gone with the wind, gone with the wind, never to return. And now we're in a huge situation, like the Old South was, where all our cherished definitions, up in smoke, never to return. And we don't want to turn into moonshiners, you know? We don't want to be drinking white lightning. We don't want to be following the mind's prescriptions. The mind will say, don't worry, here's a prescription for you. Just go, you know, drink, make some moonshine. Well, in North Carolina, way back in the hills, lived my old pappy and had him a still. He brewed white lightning till the sun went down. Then he filled him a jug and he passed it around. Mighty, mighty pleasing, pappy's corn squeezing. Woo! White lightning. So we don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. We don't want to get into the mind's prescriptions. But as these definitions are go up in smoke, gone with the wind, we're going to feel like, oh, I gotta cling to something, I gotta cling to something, I gotta cling to something. So the temptation is to align with the mind and follow its prescriptions, and then maybe lots of people will come to you and say, oh, thank you for giving us this prescription. But it's still, it's a mental prescription, so I have to be very adamant about it. The prescription is that you write the mind a new prescription. That is the answer. There's no other answer. No other answer. I'm not going anywhere else. That is the answer. I don't care what you think some guru, so what somebody says some guru told them, or what prescription, etc., etc., etc. The mind can write infinite prescriptions and say that the guru said this is the prescription. Or it can have a guru write the prescription. No, the prescription is for you, for a spirit to write mind a new prescription. That is the answer. There is no other answer. That is the answer. So we just abide in that. Stay with that. We're not going to get off track into something else. The mind keeps trying to get me off track. And tries to say, well, wait a minute now, you know, Ananda Mayima said this, or she said this, and this. I don't care what Ananda Mayima said, or anybody else, what they said, because that's the mind saying what they said. It's the mind saying what they said. The fact is that we have to write the mind a new prescription. That is salvation. It's the only way to be saved. We have to deal with the continuity problem, and all these things now need to define life to us. Definition of life to us. We need to perceive it. Definition of life. To feel it, to hear it, to smell it, to taste it, to definition of life. That is the answer. I don't care what the mind claims that such and such says, or whatever it is, we're sticking to this. We're sticking with it. We're not going to get thrown off the spinning wheel into some other, you know, some definition that the mind is giving. I was at a fun house when I was a kid in San Francisco, Ocean Beach, and there was this huge wooden platter, and everybody got on it, and they started to spin the wooden platter, and the faster the spun, you'd slide off, because the centrifugal force, or whatever it calls, the centripetal force, centripetal, and I was the only one that remained on the spinning platter. And I was near the center, I was very near the center, and I was determined not to go off. So I have that same determination now, is we're sticking with what is salvation. That is spirit writing mind a new prescription, giving it a new idea, saying, mind, the new idea is prep me to accept what I am, accept myself as God created me, prepare me for that. All right, give me a definition of that. Give me a definition of life. Give me a definition of reality. I want you to define, give me definitions of reality. Define it for me. Prepare me through definitions for reality. And then mind will obediently do that for us. Absolutely. But we have to give mind the prescription. We can't say, hey, mind, write us a prescription. Because mind is already has the marching orders to try to teach spirit how to die. So it can't stop that. So all its prescriptions will be for the purpose of continuing to teach, try to teach spirit how to die, which is impossible, miserable, suffering, futile, a morbid movie of mortality. So stay strong. Don't go flying off right now. Don't go flying off. And I'll see what I can do. If you start to fly off, maybe I can help a little bit. We'll see. All right, for right now, we're going to end this one. And I might attach a video to the, you know, to the end of this and edit some more videos into it. It's possible. I've got to wait till people go to sleep because right now there's neighbors all over the place. They're not going to be singing and playing guitar or whatever. So, all right, very great. That is it for this one. Hang tight there. Hang loose, hang tight. Don't go flying off. Stay centered.